Welcome to the Online Great Books podcast, brought to you by onlinegreatbooks.com, where we talk about the good life, the great books, great conversation, and great ideas. I'm Scott Hambrick.
I'm Karl Schutt.
And today on the Online Great Books podcast, we're going to talk about Isaac Asimov's book, The Naked Sun. S-U-N.
Yes.
S-U-N.
Make sure you spell it right.
Yeah, I got another book typo. It's the wrong one.
Isaac Asimov, big part of my life, probably not entirely for the better. 1920, 1992, Russian immigrant.
Prolific.
Yeah. Wrote about everything. He's a polymath. I mean, he wrote books about the Bible. He didn't believe a word of it, I don't think, but he wrote intelligent books about the Bible and about all sorts of things. I used to get his magazine, Isaac Asimov Science Fiction magazine, and he would have a column in there every quarter when it came out, or every month when it came out. It's kind of a big deal. The Foundation series would be something to read someday, except it's like 5 books long, and I don't want to inflict that on you.
Yeah, we'll get to it. Some days long.
Big stories with big ideas, generally, in my opinion, characters that lack a little bit of characterization.
Yeah, that's fine.
But not a lot of romance. But what he did, so we're doing one of the robot stories. So he came up with, see, before that, robots were scary things in stories.
Wait a minute. Before?
Before Isaac Asimov.
Oh, I'm scared to death of them.
Well, so am I. But he's got the good robots.
What?
Well, all right. What is a robot? A robot is a slave.
Okay.
That's what the word means. I think it's a Czech word or something. A robot is something that must obey in the original word, and it came to be mechanical. And we have all sorts of stories about robots going crazy and killing us all. Mm-hmm. Asimov starts writing stories. I think the first one was Robbie. It's about a kid being raised by a robot. He starts writing stories where the robots are not bad.
Thanks, Isaac. Can I tell you about one of my favorite things before we get into this story?
Sure.
Our friend Trent Jones, who is our co-host on the Music and Ideas podcast that you should go listen to, guys, put together a playlist for the show we just recorded where we talk about funk. And he reintroduced me to something that I already knew, but I forgot about. And I didn't know I loved it as much as I do. And we hope that that show introduces you to things that maybe you didn't know about that are good and beautiful and true, and maybe reopens the eyes to stuff that you did know about and lets you see just how awesome it is. And I want to play a little chunk because I'm absolutely in love with Lynn Collins and her song Think. This is from our
show. All right, I'll put robots on hold for a moment.
Yeah, this is from our show on funk over at the Music and Ideas podcast. Preach. Let me tell you something. The sisters are not going for that no more. Because we realize 2 things. That you aren't doing anything for us. That we better do by ourselves. So from now on, we're going to use what we got to get what we want. So, you'd better think. Ah. Think. That's so good.
It's and, tasty.
Trent put it back in front of me and reminded me that I loved it, and I thank him for that. Hopefully, if you go listen to that show, you'll hear all kinds of little ear nuggets in there that reawaken something in you and make your life a little bit better. So go try out that show. You were going to say something, Carl.
I was going to say, so it's about robots, except that's not why I picked this particular book.
Oh, no.
No, it is about robots. So Asimov had his 3 laws of robotics, which are you'll see it in later science fiction and movies, things that are built into the brains of the robots so they can't kill you. So first law, a robot may not injure a human being or through inaction allow a human being to come harm. Second law, a robot must obey the orders given it by human beings, except where such orders would conflict with the first law. Third, the robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second law.
Those sound like good laws.
Yes and no. There's some wiggle room. There's some gaps in that which are explored in the story.
No, but I thought you just had to make a law and then reality would conform to it. What do you mean wiggle room? He declared what the laws are.
Well, but the robot doesn't know if your action... Well, okay.
What?
Well, if we invent a Socrates robot, Scott, the Socrates robot would say, what does harm mean? What does injure mean? If I knock you to the ground, that looks like harm, right? And so I shouldn't do it. But if I knock you to the ground to get you out of the way of the truck that's coming right at you, that's not harm.
But we need to pass some more laws.
Well, if you could wire the laws positronically into the brain,
right,
then maybe you could. So if you watch Star Trek and note that Mr. Data, also a robot, has a positronic brain, that's stolen straight out of Isaac Asimov. Whatever a positron is, he just that's how robot brains work. They're positronic. It's magic.
Is it a brand like Kleenex or a Torque Flight, like a transmission or?
Sure, you go to the positron factory and you get your positrons downloaded into your positronic brain. I don't know. You could read iRobot, and if which is his first collection of stories that he wrote, if you want to learn more about that. And so he had three novels written with an odd detective pairing with a human named Elijah Baley and a robot named R. Daniel Oliver. The R stands for robot. That's Case of Steel, The Naked Sun, S-U-N, and Robots of Dawn. I've read all three of them. I can't remember the last one. Read them as a kid. And it's clever, and you're trying to figure out the robots add something to it, so you're trying to figure out how the murders happen if there's robots all around. So they're kind of fun detective stories. Now, the reason I picked The Naked Sun for us to read, can you guess?
Yes.
Would you care to?
Sure. Well, in The Naked Sun, the human detective lives cloistered in a city and is not allowed to go outside, and no one is allowed to go outside, and the cities are all underground, and he essentially has agoraphobia, and he is transported to another planet where everyone lives alone.
Yep. Solaria is the name of the planet. This might resonate with the current situation for you out there, dear listener. The best of science fiction, so there's mid-century science fiction, which is where I would consider it the best. They would take big ideas and see how humans would react to big ideas.
You know, there was an optimism in that mid-century science fiction that might be unwarranted, might be naive, but is pleasing to me. I like Roddenberry's universe in Star Trek, you know. I like the idea that at some point we could push a button and a turkey dinner would come out of the wall, and that would free us up to explore and be scientists and engineers and doctors and do the things that interested us. And no matter how stupid that idea actually is, it feels good to entertain it.
And then what would happen is, if it's a good author, and they're not all optimistic,
right.
Harlan Ellison's not optimistic, Philip K. Dick,
yeah.
The scariest story in the world is, I forget the title of it, but it's about mechanized warfare. So you're talking about, you press the button, you get the turkey dinner. All right. Let's say that's true.
No.
What would happen next? And so what these authors would do would say, take a world where you could replicate food instantly with the press of a button. What would it be like?
Yeah.
You know, or Dick saying, well, what if we had mechanized soldiers, robot soldiers? What would happen next? You know, or Larry Niven's, like, what if we had instant teleportation? What would happen next? And he invented flash mobs. We don't have teleportation, but, you know, something goes out on the socials and thousands of people show up instantly. And so they're entertaining as stories. To me, they were entertaining. I spent a lot of my childhood reading this kind of stuff. But they're also, they stretch your ideas and think, if this happens, then what else would happen?
Yeah.
A little playground for the mind. And so in The Naked Sun, you know, if you could mechanize your work, what would happen? What would happen if we did have robots? And we don't have androids. We haven't gone that way, but we have, we're going to have self-driving cars and mutual funds that are run by an AI for example. Who knows, your kids might be taught by a robot pretty soon. It won't be an android. It won't be C-3PO. You know, our friend Eric at OGB, he's a teacher, says, you know, he's teaching to a bunch of black screens because they don't even turn their screens on. Well, might as well just not turn his screen on and just right. put a script.
Is he teaching robots?
Well, he might as well be one,
yeah.
I guess. For me, that was the interesting part of the story. There's some stuff that comes up that might be of interest to you. It's also a pretty good story, I thought. Did you like it?
I did. It's a cautionary tale that no one paid any attention to, apparently.
Well, that's the problem with this sort of thing. Nobody ever does pay attention. But if you read it, you might know what's coming. So Elijah Baley is a detective on Earth, a plainsclothesman. The Earth has dug cities down into the ground, and like beehive cities.
I don't remember why they had done that. I don't remember any stories about nuclear war or anything like that, but they did.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's too worked out. The spacemen had left earlier, and the Earthmen had turned back inwards. So there was a bunch of humans that went off into space and built these colonies, and on Earth, Earth's kind of a backwater. So this is page 3 of my edition. The galaxy was close to Earthmen. It was preempted by the spacers. And Earth's city civilization completed the task, imprisoning Earthmen within the cities by a wall of fear of open spaces that barred them from the robot-run farming and mining areas of their own planet. And he talks about his life, and I thought it was interesting. He can't just go anywhere he wants. He needs a transient permit for the community bathroom.
Yeah, I highlighted the exact same thing. That's the first highlight in the book. He can't go anywhere he wants without a permit. But there's a flip side to that. He doesn't really want to go anywhere either.
Yeah, he's content.
He gets summoned to, I don't know, like he lives in New York City, which is now underground, and he gets summoned to, I guess, D.C., Washington, D.C., or Washington, they call it at this point, and he doesn't want to go. And I get it. I don't either. I'm trying not to leave Rogers County. I get it, but his reasons for staying home are different than mine. Let me say that. Yeah. He says, I'll just read a little chunk here so you get a little flavor. Baley glanced at his watch and decided there was time for freshening before taking the expressway to the Justice Department. He was glad there was. The sound and clamor of life, the huge vaulted chamber of the airport with city corridors leading off on numerous levels, everything else he saw and heard gave him the feeling of being safely and warmly enclosed in the bowels and womb of the city. It washed away anxiety, and only a shower was necessary to complete the job. He needed a transience permit to make use of one of the community bathrooms, but presentation of his travel orders eliminated any difficulties. There was only routine stamping with private stall privileges, the date carefully marked to prevent abuse, and a slim strip of directions for getting to the assigned spot. Nope.
It's pretty regimented. Well, if you have a billion people living in one city... You said this on an earlier podcast. Maybe you need all those rules.
Yeah. I used to have a transient permit to go navigate the hall and go to the bathroom when I was in school.
You could just go?
No. You had to get a hall pass and you go.
Was it attached to like a big plank of wood?
Right. Me being the kind of guy I was, I always wanted to just deuce on their desk. Because it was just an indignity to have to tell Mrs. Dobbs, that I needed to go void. So awful. It's like, you know what?
I bet you put it that way too.
Yeah. Mrs. Dobbs, I need to go void my bowels. Can I have the hall pass, please? She hands me a hubcap with a chain on it.
Well, yeah, it's a managed life. One of the things that he's very concerned about, we haven't even got to the story yet. I'm not sure what the C stands for, but he's recently been promoted from C5 to C6.
Right.
Okay, so you have a ranking in the society. Presumably there's if their food's being provided by robots, they probably don't have to work for a living. But you have a status in your society, which is determined by, I don't know, contributions you've made. So he's gone up from C5 to C6. The higher you are in the society, the more privileges you have. He's complaining because he's only a C6. He doesn't really have much pipe tobacco. They all smoke in Asimov's novels. He doesn't. In the future, apparently, everybody smokes.
I agree with that.
And he might be able to get a C7. Then his wife and his one child can be a little bit higher on the social standing. I mean, he's got a credit score that he's very concerned about.
Like a social credit score?
Yeah.
I didn't really think of it as a social credit score. You know, if you're in the civil service now, they give you these jobs are like, oh, that's a GS-12.
Yeah.
You know, I just thought it was like that, but maybe you're right.
Well, they're going to send him to Solaria. He's a detective. That's his job. They're going to send him off to Solaria because there has been a murder on this exotic, strange world, and they don't know how to deal with it.
Everybody lives alone there in Solaria, so they don't have murders. It's nobody's ever in the same room together.
Right. There's 20,000 people on this planet, and each one of them has an estate.
Yeah, which is hundreds to maybe even multiple thousands of square miles each.
Yeah, which is another one of these ideas in this book. If you had a robot economy, how many humans do you need for economic efficiency?
Right. If they're only economic units or production units, how many do you need? And the answer to that is enough to watch the robots, whatever that is. But if you're like me and you think that they are ends of themselves, then you don't even ask questions like that. How many do you need?
So that idea of 20,000 people, I remember reading this as a kid and this freaking me out, you know? And you think, well, why not? That's the problem, these ideas. Well, why wouldn't that be great if I have a bunch of robot servants and have my own place? Interesting ideas. Well, anyway, he's going to be sent off there. If he does a good job solving the murder, he'll be up to C7 for his wife and kid and himself. They also want him to spy on Solarians. There's political things going on. There's one other thing about the spacers. These are the people that have gone in the future. They are pathologically afraid of disease. You say. they're pathologically afraid of disease, so they never come into contact with each other.
Yeah, I remember reading in the Hornblower books, and he said that you would think that the ship would be in the best condition the day it leaves the port. He said, oh, no, that's not the case at all. It's muddy. There have been people in and out, and, you know, as they loaded supplies and so on, and then they would have, you know, these crews would come together after leave, and then they would leave, and the boat would be just a mess. And it would take them a few days to get it all cleaned up and ship shape, you see. And then people would start getting sick.
Mm-hmm.
But after they had been out for 2 or 3 weeks, everybody would have already passed around the flu or whatever it is they had on the boat. And then the boat would get healthy and it would be clean. And the boat and the crew were never in better condition than one moment just before they docked on their return. So I thought about that when I was reading about these spacers. You know, you could imagine that, you know, you leave whatever spaceport and you head out to whatever far-flung galaxy or whatever you're going to, and people would pass around the common cold until everybody had got it. And then eventually, whatever diseases are on that ship would have killed anybody that was going to kill. Everybody else would have gotten and recovered, and then it would no longer be a problem. So if you go settle a new land, a new planet, and there are no diseases on that planet to begin with, there would be no viral or bacteriological disease on that planet.
Right. And they would be afraid if Elijah Baley shows up and has some sort of disease, it might wipe out the whole planet.
Right. Yes, and their concerns aren't voiced in that way. It's all about disgust and fear. You know, at the end of the book, a Solarian touches a person. It's a big moment. Like, this stuff isn't, it's not, maybe once it was rational. Maybe at some point in the history of the spacers it was rational. But at this point, it's almost like ancestral memory.
Mm-hmm.
And they have a disgust for other people in contact that they can't account for, at least in that moment. We're never going to get this book talked about. You know, my grandmother was born in 1920, and so she grew up during the Great Depression here in Oklahoma, which has never been a wealthy place. And she's one of those, and a lot of folks have people like this in their family that would wash out those plastic bags and reuse that wrapping paper and, you know, save the twist ties off of the bread sacks. You might use that for something. You know, the Great Depression formed the way she saw resources of all kinds. And I think we all know a lot of people like that. And she probably, I never talked to her about this.
I don't know that the kids know anybody like that.
They might not. Charity's granddad told me a story one time about, he said, there was plenty of work to be had during the Great Depression, but there wasn't any money. There wasn't currency. There wasn't specie to exchange for work. So he said that he would end up doing work for goods. You know, he would go work for somebody for 2 or 3 weeks and they'd give him a pig, a piglet, or, you know, that kind of thing, because there was no money to pay. That kind of an environment shaped those people's lives from then on. You know, my grandmother, Charity's granddad, Leroy, and so many others. And these spacers have this phobia. And I often wonder, if there's a 3, 5, 8, 10, 12-year-old kid out there right now who's been under lockdown, whose mom is swabbing him down with hand sanitizer and yelling at him for not putting on his mask, how does that person kiss a girl? Ever.
Cellophane.
you take Susie to the skating rink and you're going to kiss her and you're like, get your dental dam.
It's part of the reason I picked this book. I figured in our current situation, there might be some things that would make you think, dear listener, about what we are. Wrought is the past tense. What's the present tense of wrought?
Are rotting.
What we have wrought.
Yes.
There might be some sociological effects that we don't know. And Solaria could be like 1,000 years after the Corona plague.
Yeah. You know, he's got this world building just so we can explore these ideas about, you know, Solarians being solitary or the agoraphobia of the Earthmen. And when you read this, when I read this, well, it's obvious that these people's choices are going to have far-flung and far-reaching consequences, right? If robots are highly efficient and very inexpensive and you're in space and people are scarce, that is going to have consequences, clearly.
Mm-hmm.
How is life different than that? It's not. Like, you know, whatever you come down on, you know, politically, you know, for some reason, this disease is a political issue. But wherever you come down on this, like, it's clear that there are going to be far-reaching consequences with how it's dealt with. You know, pick your favorite way to deal with it. I don't care. There are going to be knock-on effects of that really need to be thought about. And it doesn't seem like, and maybe we haven't had time to think about it. Although, well, last March, maybe we didn't have time to think about it. But it's, we're coming into the, 11th month of this? 10th month of this?
Yeah, so something like this, you can think through it. You could see, it's a fun book anyway, trying to figure out how the murders were committed, where the murder weapon is, you know, how the guy gets poisoned by his robot. How can any of this stuff happen? And you can work through some of the puzzles and try to figure it out. But the sociological exploration that Asimov is doing here is interesting to me. So because the Solarians don't ever see anybody. They view them. Okay, even husband and wife don't see each other except, you know, for the few moments that they have to, and they have to because they don't like doing this when they have to in order to procreate.
Yeah.
It's icky.
Yeah, there's a terrible four-letter word on Solaria. Love.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was children, but then I thought that's not four letters.
Right. Well, she calls it a four-letter word. You know, he talked about affection, and she shudders and gags.
Poor Gladia.
Gladia, the Solarian, you know, the idea of affection is, in her mind, linked with, you know, touching, maybe an embrace.
She's a femme fatale, by the way.
Yeah, she is. Ingenue.
Yeah, she's playing him the whole time.
Yeah. So the idea of affection is tied up with, you know, touch, an embrace, et cetera. And he mentions affection and she recoils and gags.
Yeah.
And she says, oh, you're just trying to shock me. I'll say the four-letter word, love. How about that?
Because they're never in physical contact. And can you have, is a viewed relationship, and basically a Zoom call, is a viewed relationship, viewing is like 3D Zoom. is that the same as physical contact?
Seeing. Yeah, early in the book, they make the distinction between viewing and seeing. So he's talking to this, Elijah is having essentially a Zoom call with this Gladia chick, and she's in the bathtub or the shower or something, and she just is nude and comes into view while he gasps and turns away. And she says, "What are you talking about? What's your big deal? You didn't see me. You viewed me."
Yeah, she did that on purpose, though.
Well, of course she did. Because she had researched the Earthmen and knew what their taboos were. But in all of the Solarian characters, there is a distinction between seeing and viewing, though.
Yeah, but they don't ever want to see anybody.
They never want to see anybody. That's too private. You could view her on essentially a Zoom call, nude, no big deal. She doesn't care. If you actually walked into the room and saw her, lose our mind.
To think about this, so I had a class a while back when one of my colleagues had passed away, and I had to take he got sick, and I had to take over his class, and I couldn't do it the 3 days a week, so I did one day a week through a web interface. Mm-hmm. It was strange. Kids won't talk it now, anyways. At least I've found this to be the case in my 20 years or so of teaching in university, that they got less and less gregarious with actual physical words in front of each other. Mm-hmm. As the time went on, I think that's a trend, but I'm the only sample. And they wouldn't talk. I'd say, "Does anyone have any questions?" Nobody would say anything. "Anyone have any reactions?" Nobody would say anything. In the chat, though, they would talk up a storm.
Right.
They don't want to use their voices, but they'll type a whole bunch of stuff. And the chat was actually fun and interesting, except that we're humans and we should probably talk.
Right.
I'm old fashioned. I think we ought to talk.
My children have trouble making phone calls.
Oh, so do I.
I'll tell them, "Hey, call that store and see if they've got whatever, and then tell them to hold it for us, so we'll go pick it up." You know, for example, or call that restaurant and make a reservation for us. You know, tell them hamburger for 4 at 7.
Do you end up with hamburger for 7 at 4?
Right. I end up making the call. So what ends up happening. I'm taking a welding class, Carl.
I've heard.
And I was in the welding class, and the instructor is a good welder, but he might not be a very good instructor. And he was talking about welding rod. There are different numbers for these rods. There's four. It's a four-digit number, 6010, 6011, 7018, whatever. And he's just talking about these numbers. And... Well, he's just throwing these numbers out, and we're talking about, well, we'll use this rod for that and this rod for this. But he didn't describe what the numbers were. I'm the oldest person in the class. Nobody said anything. And I'm thinking, he needs to tell me what these are. I actually knew what they were, but I'm thinking, he needs to say what this is, because I could look around the room. I could tell nobody knew what the hell he was talking about. And I thought, I'm going to sit here and just see how long it takes for one of these Zoomers to ask. Ever never. That's when.
They're Solarians.
Yep. Yep.
Technological Solarians. They're used to interaction through a mediation of a gadget and aren't too comfortable with doing it any other way.
So I said, "Hey, Mr. Cooper, what do those numbers mean? What do those four digits mean?" "Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot." And he's like, "Thanks, Frat." Yeah.
Yeah, what are we... I need to find out the present tense of rot, because I want to say it. What are we reeking? That's not the right word, though. I don't know. When I have time, I'll look it up on the OED dictionary, which is a membership perk at Online Great Books.
One of many.
Like, I know that fraught is the past tense of freight, but I don't think rot is the past tense of rate.
Rot, used only in past tense.
Oh.
Is an old form of the past tense of work. So the present tense, oh. I guess, is work.
Work, rot. Oh, well, what are we working? And it might not be so good. And I harken back to a very early show that we did, which was Gabriel Marcel talking about technology and whether the virtues that we have are adequate to deal with them. Mm-hmm. And so we're putting everybody on screens and on Zoom. And we don't know what that's going to do to us. And we haven't developed it's like if there had never been fermented grape juice on this planet. Okay. Imagine you're the first one to invent booze, alcohol.
Okay.
And then you drop it in all the major cities.
Oh, gosh.
What would happen?
Wouldn't be good.
It'd take a couple hundred years before people figure out how to drink it reasonably. Well, we're kind of doing that with these gadgets that we have our faces in all the time. But, you know, this Naked Sun is like 1950 or something.
A smart dude, man.
Yeah, it's predictive. Well, we could do some of the story. Well, he meets his robot friend. I'm not sure they're friends. They get more friendly as the books go on. Baley has some... R. Daniel Oliva is an android. He is designed to look human.
He tricks people. He's a good enough android that he tricks people.
Yeah, and Bailey's not sure what he thinks about that, but Daniel has been helpful to him, and they're as friendly probably as a human and a robot could be.
Yeah, Elijah says over and over again, Baley says over and over again, that robots are logical but not reasonable.
Yeah.
What the heck does that mean?
Well, for example, when they're taking the car to their estate, because they built them a whole estate. If you go visit Solaria, you're not going to stay in a hotel. They're going to have the robots build you a mansion. And then when you leave, they're going to tear it down.
Yeah, because you're gross.
Well, and labor's cheap. And imagine labor being effectively free. What kind of house would you build if it cost you nothing to build it?
Labor is cheap. And resources, natural resources are plentiful there. But you're gross.
Yeah, that too. Yeah, but that's a thing to think about, you know, with 3D printing and automation of the production processes. If it got to the point where you could build a whole lot of stuff for almost no effort, what then? What would happen? Well, they might build you mansions. Well, anyway, he's on the way, and Elijah knows that he's claustrophobic. Because he's been living in the Caves of Steel on Earth. That's the first novel, by the way, Caves of Steel. But he wants to bust out of it, because how is he going to solve a murder on Solaria if he can't even look at the sky? And so he wants to open the window, and Daniel won't let him, because first law, can't allow a human to come to harm.
Yeah, he was afraid that the open spaces and viewing the sun and feeling the wind in his face would harm Baley.
Which it would, except that he wants to do it anyway. So logical, not reasonable. The greater harm is not being able to get out of your enclosed area and do your job. So what counts as harm in this case?
Yeah, there's a time horizon based for these decisions, right? You take a very, very strong antibiotic, it might give you diarrhea. But you might not die of whatever.
Right.
So there's a calculus that always has to be done.
Right.
See, this is the thing that Musk doesn't talk about. Well, these robots have to have, they have to hold things in relative values, and they have to know what a higher good is so they can do that calculus and figure out when to take the medicine. You know, chemotherapy is just darn near deadly. Right.
Yes.
But
just darn near.
Darn near deadly. And somebody's got to figure out, you know, how much harm to place the patient under or apply to the patient in order to save the patient. And you have to have a set of, I hate the word values. That's been so messed up. But you have to have priorities and things that you hold dear to be able to figure that out. And somebody has to put that in the robots, because mm-hmm. they can't do it themselves.
Well, it'd be good if more humans had it. I was thinking there were... People were playing around on one of the social media sites, I don't want to mention them, and putting chatbots out, artificial intelligence chatbots, and having them learn. And they were all ending up like terribly racist. Because they were logical, but not reasonable.
Yeah, it happens over and over again. I don't like that term values. It equates these notions of virtue with some sort of economic decision, right? You know, to call it a value. Mm-hmm. It's not a good word. And the conservatives like to hammer on values, but they would be better off if they hammered on virtue.
Yeah, or on truth and goodness.
Truth and goodness. I'd take that. That'd be nice.
Yeah. Values are kind of floating, ephemeral. I don't usually think of it as economic. I think of it as, well, subject, it's volitional. You can decide to value something. And I think that's wrong. I think you recognize something and then value it. And then it would be okay. But if you just decide, I'm going to value pink bananas, well, that's crazy.
And saying something like family values, well, what, that doesn't really mean anything.
No, the family is a good, and therefore you may value it.
That doesn't tell us what to do. Right.
But saying family values means, well, I suppose I can value my family if I want to, and if not, I can go out for a cigarette and not come back.
I knew a guy I went to high school with. His dad was painting the living room. He said, I'm going to go get another gallon of paint. Never came back. So we all know that trolley car problem.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we don't. The trolley car problem. There is a trolley car rolling down the hill out of control. It is coming up to a Y in the track. You have a lever in your hand that can make the trolley car go right or make it go left. If it goes right, it kills some number of people. If it goes left, it kills another higher number of people. What do you do? No, wait a minute. No, that's not it. If it goes right, it kills somebody. If you don't throw the switch, it kills that person. If you do throw the switch, it kills a smaller number of people. Is that what it is?
Or it might be one's a bunch of kids in their school bus and one isn't. You know, it's a way to judge moral values on human life. Or way to test your value of
one them. Of the choices you could make would be do nothing and, you know, claim that you're not culpable or whatever sometimes.
Yeah, they had this in the Batman movies, by the way, but then they chickened out and didn't make him choose.
Yeah,
the Joker did it to Batman in one of the Nolan Batman films.
Blah. So Musk is making these driverless cars. So somebody has to program that car and tell it how to make decisions.
Yep. Does it run up on the curb and avoid the crash and kill the people on the curb?
So let's say there are five people standing in the intersection, and they shouldn't be there. But there are five people in the intersection, and there are me and my two children and my wife in the car. Well, that's four people. And the only way to not kill those five is to hit a tree and kill all of us. Well, I want that car to kill those five people. It's my car. That car needs to make decisions on my behalf for my family.
But it's a robot car.
But it's a robot car by Musk Corp. And Musk's company would say, boy, it would be cheaper for us to pay the settlement on the death of the four than the five. Anyway, I'm not interested in this driverless car shit. Because I don't know what all the judgments are that are programmed into the thing when I get in it. And,
sure.
And there are a bunch of spurgs right now saying, oh, but its reactions times are safer. And I don't care because I'm not afraid of cars, you see. I'm not afraid of driving. I don't care about the reaction times. I want to know that my robot is actually working for me.
Right. You can't map easily.
Oh, it'll be safer.
But you can't map morality to economic value judgments that are subject to programming. I don't think you can do it.
And it has to be an economic judgment if a company is doing it. It has to be. There is no other judgment that can be made.
Now, I want to give you a spoiler alert. You, Scott, might wish to cover your ears.
Okay.
If you're going to read the rest of them.
I read them a long time ago.
Daniel Oliver thinks about what harm means.
Mm.
And he expands his definition.
Mm.
And it turns out this character shows up something like 20,000 years in the future in this universe. So if you read the rest of them, if you read the Foundation stories and then the stories that come after the original trilogy, you might see him again.
Does he determine that language is violence?
No, I don't think so.
Knock-knock jokes are harm?
Well, some of them are.
Well, if they're bad.
I like Asimov. I like that he's thinking through these sorts of things and not giving you easy solutions.
I think this book and the Starship Troopers book we read earlier and 2001 Space Odyssey, so many of these science fiction books are really good for young adults or kind of post-adolescents to read because it makes you practice thinking about these knock-on effects of decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it makes me wonder if people, my disgusting mayor, for example, ever read anything like this. I have no evidence that the guy understands anything about second, third, fourth order effects of anything he's ever done. GT Bynum.
Yeah, well, and they have space marines and robots in them, which is an attraction. But you're not just reading a space marine story. You're reading a space marine story that makes you think about war and peace and the costs of these things and the decisions right. people make. So they're not children's books, but they're child friendly. And no, they are children's books because a good children's book should make the darn kid think.
Yeah. They put us at enough distance from these hard decisions that we can see them in a more objective way. And practice making hard decisions. Practice thinking through difficult problems. Is there anybody in the public health sphere? I'm sure there are a few, but I haven't heard this in the public discourse whatsoever. Talking about what intimacy will be like for the children who are now birthed to age 12 as a result of this germ scare. Maybe it's a legit germ scare. Maybe it's not. It doesn't actually matter if it's legit or not. In terms of the psychology and the way they view human contact, it's going to have an effect. Is anybody even talking about it? Did anybody say?
Not very many.
I'm not hearing it.
No, I've seen stuff, not about this, but Japan, which is rather germ phobic.
Yeah.
They have a hard time getting their kids to get together physically.
Yeah.
They're not interested. Yeah. Which seems weird. How could kids not be interested? You know, it's all I thought about for a large part of my life.
I know what you mean.
Yeah. Well, especially after this funk episode we did earlier in the morning.
So, Asimov deals with this problem. Well, Solaria was founded by wealthy people who had left their more crowded planet for Solaria for essentially vacation homes, essentially. Some of them end up staying, and by, they develop a robotic technology there that's far advanced of what anybody else has. And eventually, they become very protective of this planet because they took it on as a vacation home to get away from the hustle and bustle of wherever. They don't want it to become any more crowded than it already was. So they limit the population to 20,000 people. So you can't have as many kids as you want, but we do need to have some. So people are ordered to have children from time to time. And those children are those foeti. What? How do you call it? What do you say? Those fetuses are harvested, raised in a test tube, essentially. Then the state raises the kids. And of course, the people of Solaria are disgusted by human contact, so they don't want to hold the children. So they have robots that hold and nurture the children, because we know from studies that if young mammals aren't handled and cared for, they die. It's not just about nutrition. And they have a big problem because the young children want to play together. And at some point, they have to socialize them to fear the other children.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is an instinct that they have. The first character that's murdered believes that for just a few more generations that they will have extinguished that instinct to socialize in those children.
I don't find this as far-fetched as I did.
No.
When I read this back in 1985.
Yeah, how prescient is this guy? How about this? Not at all. If you set up a world like he does and you describe it as he did, I think the sociological consequences that he lays out were just natural consequences of what he's put forth here. It didn't have to happen because of Spanish flu or whatever. It didn't have to. So is he making predictions? I don't think he's actually making predictions necessarily. He just says, what if it was like this? This is one of the things that could happen. His world building seems dead nuts on to me.
Yeah, it's working out the consequences of his starting point. It's not, I'm going to write a novel to predict the future. I think if you'd told him, you know what, you predicted a future pretty kind of closely, he'd probably be horrified.
Right. Oops. Oh, no.
I didn't want to.
Right.
You know, it's like writing a dystopian zombie novel and having it come true. Oh, you were so prescient. I don't know. Do we want to solve the murder mystery? Or we just want to talk about Zoom calls?
We could solve the mystery. No one is supposed to be in the presence of other people except married couples, and then only rarely and grudgingly. A gentleman is killed.
Ricane Delmar is dead.
And everybody says, well, we know who did it. We just have to figure out how and why. They believe his wife did it because, remember, the robots are programmed. It's ingrained in their very neurology that they can do no harm, essentially. They have to comply to with these three rules. So nobody on this planet believes that that any of the robots could have had a hand in it.
Yeah, so Gladia is the suspect. She's the wife. She's an interesting character. She's not a good Solarian. She is affectionate. The programming didn't take.
She's a woman of passion.
Yeah, she kind of hates her husband because he doesn't want to have anything to do with her.
I did.
You hated the husband?
No, she sounds lovely.
Yeah. She's a hothouse flower, but she doesn't want to be in the hothouse. She wants to get out, but she doesn't know it. But they're trying to figure out how this could have happened with robots all around and people only viewing each other and not seeing each other. What Solarian could possibly have even dared to be in another's presence to commit a murder? It's so foreign to them. It's like, you know, you were talking earlier about your kids on the phone. Who uses the phone? It's unthinkable.
Right.
You're the only person that calls me.
I know.
Whenever the phone rings, it's either telling me that my car registration or that my car warranty is about to expire, or it's you.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if I want to solve it. I think I might want to let them solve it.
Yeah, there are big problems. Gosh, it's interesting. I kind of do want to solve it so we can talk about some of these problems.
Okay.
Maybe we can talk about them without doing it. There are problems with the three laws of robotics, and all the Solarians are technologists. They are socialized in such a way that they can't conceive of any problems with those rules. They have such a narrow conception of, you know, how to formulate problems of justice that they cannot figure out how the rules could be wrong.
Yeah, they don't see that there's a problem. They probably think harm is such an obvious category that they can't see how there's room. Yes. Baley can see it because Baley had to do it. It's a reasonably well-constructed novel, and it gives you clues all the way through. In the beginning, he has to trick Daniel Oliva to get the window open. He won't do it, and I forget exactly how he does it, but he has his robot companion lower the window to the person in the front who's not a person, who's a robot. And then once the window is open, Baley says, open the window for the... I want to see the outside. And then before it can be stopped, the thing's open. So he has to trick his partner to get the window open. There's ways around the harm law because the robot doesn't have perfect knowledge.
Yeah. And nobody does.
Nobody does. You don't know what harm is necessarily. Certainly not without thinking of second and third order effects.
And maybe even then.
Maybe even then. And so let's say that you wanted to... There's a character who is poisoned. He doesn't die, but he's poisoned. How would you poison a person whose only servants are robots bound by the three laws?
You have to find a way to poison him that the robots wouldn't be aware of. They're not aware of all possible kinds of harms, and they're not aware of everything in their universe, but they're logical, not reasonable. So being logical and not reasonable, they don't know the things they don't know. That's the thing about logic, is you don't really know about the unknowns.
Right. So you could tell one of them to put a certain compound in a glass and then leave it on the counter and then leave the room. And then you could have the other one come in as he's accustomed to do and get the water for his master and use the cup that's been poisoned. And neither of them knows. You can't tell the first one poison your master. He won't do it. But you can put a chemical in a glass. He's a scientist. He does it all the time. Neither of the agents has any knowledge. I don't know that robots have knowledge at all anyway, but uh-oh. Neither of the agents.
Whoa. Oh, what do they have, Karl?
They have programming.
But they have like all the log charts in their head. They know logarithms and
no, they don't the know roots. A thing. Your computer does not what? Know a thing.
But if I ask him the 43rd digit of pi, he knows that. He can tell me
nope,
that.
That's not what you're doing.
What?
you're using it like an abacus.
But
the abacus doesn't know the answer to the problem on the abacus. You're moving sliders over, except they're electrons in integrated circuits, flipping little tiny transistors.
What then is knowledge?
Knowledge is grasping the form. The universal. It's meaning, and meaning is not the same thing as data. Data is nothing unless there's an entity capable of meaning looking at it. And I'm not convinced that a computer program, no matter how complicated, is going to be able to do that. AI mimics what beings who understand meaning can do.
Right.
Is there a different... I mean, this is another question. This is another big question. Is Olivaw a human? I mean, he's a robot. Is he a person? What makes a person? If he imitates a person well enough, is he one? Is that the Turing test? Is that all that counts? I don't think so. I don't like the Turing test.
Not I.
I don't think it works. But that's a big question. That's not why I picked the book, but that's another big question. Is what makes a person? And if you have a human-shaped object that acts like a human, it's not a human, I don't think.
It'd be important to know what those humans are in order to figure out how to make decisions about them, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so how are you going to do trolley problems when you don't know what a human is? Because you don't know anything because you're a computer.
Right.
I don't know. I'm a bit nervous about it.
And behind all decisions are these unspoken assumptions or unspoken decisions about what the good is. And I'm not always the best at knowing what the good is. But I darn sure don't trust Walmart to tell me what it is, or Samsung, or anybody else.
Yeah.
That's in here, too.
Yeah, we always come back to this. These are the big questions to ask, and you might be frustrated at not getting easy answers to it, because there aren't any. I remember this line from Lois McMaster Bujold. I think that's her name. I read a lot of science fiction novels. She's written a bunch. She's a pretty good writer. I got to meet her once. But she had this line in one of her novels. One of her characters is having this moral dilemma. Humans don't add up like numbers. They add up like infinities. And I thought that was a really good line.
I like that.
Which doesn't mean you're not going to flip the switch on a trolley car, but it's not an economic calculation.
Unless it is.
It's a heart-wrenching calculation that you're going to hate, even if you have to do it.
Unless you're a driverless car, and then there's no heart to wrench.
Yeah.
So the Solarians have to bring in this Earthman detective because they just don't know anything about crime, which is interesting. So they have to bring him in. So one of the reasons that they can't figure out the crime, one of the reasons that they have the problem with the law of robotics, Karl, they don't know enough about hurts and harms and danger. Like their world is so circumscribed and so nerfed. Soft times make soft men, man. Mm-hmm. They can't figure it out. They're not equipped for any decision making.
Well, they don't know that they need to preserve evidence, for example.
Right.
And they can't conceive that a robot could be a vector from which a murder could be committed.
Yeah, Baley says, well, you know, gosh, guys, we got to have motive, we need a weapon, and we need opportunity. They don't even know that the crime requires those three things.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting. There's a sociologist, I forget his name. The names are funny in this book. Like he just randomly put syllables together. But the sociologist...
Jothan.
No, Jothan's the robot guy.
Oh, okay.
The guy that used to go walking with Gladia. The sociologist... thinks he's a sociologist, but all he's ever done is been on Solaria. He hasn't ever read a book from Earth. Why would I do that? So this is another problem with social isolation, screen culture, is that there are going to be things you're not even going to consider. If it doesn't make it to the top of the Google page search, it doesn't exist. Because you don't know that it doesn't exist. Wait a minute. Well, you don't know that it exists. You don't know that anything's not being shown to you. Quimot is his name. What kind of a name is Quimot?
Solarian.
Solarian. I think they just pick their names like out of pronounceable syllables randomly generated.
Like orbit planets?
Yep.
I thought it was a dig at sociology. This guy just thinking about how people interact and just writing stuff, and he declares that he's the best sociologist on the planet. Well, who else is there? Well, it's just me.
Well, I guess you are then.
Yeah, I guess you are. You know, I think that work is important, being tied to the physical environment and interacting with the world around us is very, very important. And I think that it affects the way our brains work. For example, I've been thinking about this, Carl. I handed my sister a photograph the other day. My sister is, let me do some math, she is 42 years old. She did that reverse pinch thing you do on an iPhone to zoom in.
Did it work?
It did not work. And we both had a big laugh at it, you know. When you drag and drop a window on a computer, when you zoom in on an iPhone, you find out, like when I move the mouse, the pointer on the screen moves at a different rate than the mouse does. There's gearing in there, you know, and you can change that, you know. When I use an Xbox controller or sensitivity, you can set these electronic systems, these devices that we have their own set of physics in them. And it's not real. Go stretch some barbed wire fence. It's real. And I've got these chores to do, you know, and I've got kids that help me, and they are not as rooted in that world as I am, and they really struggle with it.
Well, let me play devil's advocate and argue with myself. Why do we privilege the physical world over the digital?
Because it's all there is. The digital world is a manifestation of the physical.
But if I can be a hero in Call of Duty or Mass Effect or something, and I can save the universe, and I get all of the endorphins or dopamines or whatever, and pretty computer girls pay attention to me, you know, why do I need to go outside and be disappointed with not being a hero and not having anybody pay attention to me?
Because we're designed, it's part of our telos, Carl. We're supposed to be outside. We're supposed to interact with the world. We have opposable thumbs. We don't have USB ports. We have eyes and we have senses.
Not yet.
We're made for it. And eventually, if we don't have a deep and abiding understanding of how the physical world works, the other stuff will go away too. The iPhone.
Well, unless you had robots to design it, so your next video game is made by robots.
Right. It won't be any good. Nobody will enjoy it.
Well, they won't know that it's not good. They'll just be sadder and sadder. I look sometimes at we have a very prosperous world right now.
Kind of.
And so much so that a big public health problem is obesity.
Yeah.
Throughout history, this has never been the case.
No.
It means you're doing pretty well.
By a certain set of measures.
By the standpoint of producing enough calories for your people to eat.
Yeah.
You're doing pretty well. But all you have to do to see that maybe it's not all it's cracked up to be is look at the suicide rate, which is the highest it's ever been. If things are so great, why are people so sad? Well, why are they sad? They have everything they want. Well, maybe they don't have everything they want.
They don't.
But they don't know that they want it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So speaking of the sociologist, I think it's funny that Baley decides he's just going to be rude to all the Solarians, and he calls them and wakes them up in the middle of the night. So get him on the phone or get him on the viewer. But he makes a case that there is a historical parallel between Solaria and Earth. And Baley doesn't know what it is, but sociologist says, well, it's Sparta. Well, I thought that's pretty interesting. So Sparta is very cool, obviously. However, you should know that the reason that Sparta was so cool is because they had to be, because they had to keep their slaves in order. It was a slave state. They had helots that did all of the real work, where the Spartans, well, no, the Spartans did real work too of warfare, but they had to be, there were lots of times the Spartans had to get home from war or the helots would revolt. So there was a small aristocracy, a military specialist aristocracy on top of a large slave state. So there are problems with Sparta. You know, that's why it's funny when you read, when you watch the 300, I love that movie, but when you watch that movie and the Spartans say that they're fighting for freedom, okay, for a certain value of freedom, you have to understand that. So Frank Miller's Sparta's not quite right. And Xerxes wasn't 7 feet tall.
Cool movie, though.
Yeah, I love that movie. The visuals are great.
It's great.
It's a guilty pleasure. No, it's not even guilty. I like it. I don't care if you don't think much of me for liking it. Well, Solaria, they don't have helots. They have robots that do the work and can't revolt. And he says, so we're a bit like Athens, too. We can instead model ourselves on the artistic and cultural way of life of the Athenians. Civilizations has always been pyramidal in structure. Pyramidal? As one climbs towards the apex of the social edifice, there is increased leisure and increasing opportunities to pursue happiness. As one climbs, one finds also fewer and fewer people do enjoy this more and more. Invariably, there's a preponderance of the dispossessed. And remember this, no matter how well off the bottom layers of the pyramid might be on an absolute scale, they're always dispossessed in comparison with the apex. All right, so you've got this pyramid structure society with your top level who have leisure, and then everybody else who works to support the people that have the leisure. That's what an aristocracy is. Solaria thinks they have a pyramid without a bottom. Yep. So here on Solaria, for the first time, the apex of the pyramid stands alone. And I think some of these people that push the automation of production and universal basic income, you know, I think they're thinking the same sort of thing. Well, humans will just have this leisure. One of the Congress people was saying, you know, do you really want to go back to work? That's kind of a tyranny in itself, right? Don't you want to have the freedom to not work? Well, is there anything wrong with that?
With which part?
With having the leisure class that doesn't have to do anything. So, all right, let's go back. I remember years ago, we had this notion of, you know, all the good things that computers were going to do for us. They're going to make us to have more free time to do what we wanted to do. Okay. And you probably, being in business, you probably went through this, where we're going to take paper and make it digital. We're going to do labor saving with our digital servants. Did it actually save any labor?
No.
What did humans do with these efficiency making devices?
Created more work.
They created more work. So now you got to fill out 10 TPS reports rather than one because you've got the time. So I wonder, do humans really do very well with pure leisure? If they have no external constraints, nothing, what's the point of having the top of the pyramid if you don't have a vision of what human life ought to be? I mean, this is why, you know, The Republic's a flawed book, but I love it. Okay. Well, heck, I'm take that back.
Yeah, it's not a flawed book. How dare you?
It's not a flawed book.
Perfect, but
it's not a flawed book, but Socrates has an answer for that. What the leisure class does is attempt to get a vision of the form of the good. They have a transcendental calling that they then come down and work to make the city good. Yeah. But it would be good for them to do that whether there was a city or not. But on Solaria, do they have such a transcendental calling? You know, you have that dilettante sociologist, and I mean, they make robots, I guess, but they don't do anything.
Yeah. Can you know what the good is if you don't interact with the environment, if you don't actually do work? Can you know what it is? I don't think you can.
Well, I'm not sure I know what it is, but I think it's probably not being a crappy sociologist on a...
I'm not claiming to know what it is either. But even their art is entirely and completely abstract. Like, doesn't even have manual aspects like sculpture or painting would. You know, so they don't have the facility to even express the good, really, if they found it.
Yeah, they call people good Solarians, but all that means is conformity with the cultural norms.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
You're a good Solarian if you don't ever, like, go see people.
Right. There was a thread in our Slack about what does it mean to be socialized, you know, where people are like talk about you send kids to school to be socialized.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a big long thread in there. And I've certainly got opinions about that. But the Solarians have an idea about what that means. And if you're a good Solarian, then you are completely, your actions are all congruent with the accepted idea of what Solarians are supposed to do.
Yeah.
Well, how does anybody create any sort of art if everyone is that way? You know, we just did a show on funk. James Brown was probably not properly socialized. But, you know, we got some pretty good art out of the guy as a result of that. You can't have innovation with a population that's that homogeneous of action.
You know, why would they even do anything?
Yeah, what do they do?
I mean, they don't have kids. They don't like having kids. They don't know who their kids are.
I bet they can't even kill themselves. Maybe some robot would swoop in there and cut the bed sheet around your, you know, that you're trying to hang yourself with, or.
Yeah. Yeah, there's no suicides. Well, there is one. Yeah. I forget how he does it.
A little pill, cyanide pill or something.
Right? Ah. Yeah. Boy, what an interesting book.
TLDR, we're fucking up.
Well, you might have to do things, okay? You might have to do things.
What should I be doing?
For public health. Fine. But the infection rate is not the only good that you need to worry about.
Right.
You know, the frustrating thing to me is the constant focus on that rather than, you know, heck, if I say too much, the WHO will get this podcast banned. So, you know, whatever. People have to make decisions. I get it.
Yeah,
but
sure.
It's not the only cost.
I have an 18-year-old daughter. We've been talking about all of this kind of stuff. And she says, how do you meet boys when everybody's wearing a mask? How do you flirt with a mask on?
With your eyes, obviously.
Right. I said, yeah, go to Bahrain and ask someone there. I don't know.
Eye makeup must be like doing well.
Yeah, and the clothing is going to get more risque, probably. You know, if this went on with masks and things for 25 or 30 more years, I mean, fashion would probably change.
Now, she showed me her cheekbones.
Right.
She had the cutest cheekbones.
Like, you wouldn't be able to show the area from just below the eyes to just under the chin, but pubic hair might be okay. So, you know, who knows where it would go.
But it's going to go somewhere, which is the point that you push on one end of the scale, the other end goes up.
Yeah.
Well, this is more complicated than a scale. You know, you're pushing on one end. Who knows what's going to pop up on the other end?
Ought to be real slow to make decisions and real slow to do anything.
Well, that's an argument for, I hate that word these days, but conservatism. Just the idea of you make a change, you're going to crush somebody. You think you know better. Maybe you do. Maybe it's even the right change to make. Assuming you have perfect knowledge. You're still going to crush a whole bunch of people. Like, I drive around. I drive into the city twice a week to go coach at a gym. And I drive past empty, shut down businesses. Real estate's probably real cheap. You know, if you want a storefront, except nobody's going to go to it. So we did something, we thought it was the right thing to do, but we crushed people.
All mints. Maybe it was the right thing to do. Going to be knock-on effects. Humpty Dumpty, going to have a lot of Humpty Dumpty pieces to pick up. It's a fact.
Yeah, and you know, maybe you read some of this science fiction, you might not be taken by surprise by secondary and tertiary effects. You know, the things that are going to happen. Just stop for a minute. What will society be like if these are the conditions it's going to be lived under? You know, heck, we had a thread on as I have my smartphone right here in my hand, we had a thread on our wonderful OGB Slack channel, a perk of membership, about a lady wanted to digitally downsize and was, what do we do about these cell phones which take over our lives? And so a lot of people were making suggestions. Well, we never thought about that. So when Steve Jobs came up with the iPhone, very clever, did he stop to think? Maybe he did, but he stopped to think. I've heard something like he didn't want people to have it in their face all the time, but he sure made something that was digital candy.
He also wouldn't let his kids have one.
Yeah, that's wise, I think. Drop all of these attention grabbers off into the population. What's going to happen? What's it going to be like when you have the internet and all its goodness and badness perpetually present to everybody? Good things or bad things? Can we think through this problem? Let's just do some what ifs. Does anybody do that? And stop and think, is this such a good idea?
Well, if it returns value to the shareholders, maximizes shareholder value.
I know. Apple's the most, or the biggest company or the richest company in the world right now?
I don't know. Can we agree that they're pretty big?
They're big, yeah. So they've done pretty well. But we're all hooked. You know, I think your 10-year-old has a cell phone. Your 10-year-old's seen stuff he shouldn't ought have seen.
Yep.
Stuff that he would have had to go across town to the bad section of town and to a dirty storefront to buy 30 right. years ago, even assuming he knew that there was such things. And now it's right there. Just do a simple Google search. You can find all sorts of things that, you know, what are we doing? What's the effect of that on our society? I don't think it's going to be great.
I'll tell you one of the effects. My children don't know what block number corresponds to the major streets in their town.
Because they do Google Maps all the time?
Yeah. So Yale Avenue is the 4800 block of whatever here in Tulsa. So, you know, I learned the town before there was navigation or GPS and all that stuff. So I can see an address and I know pretty close to where that thing is mm-hmm. because our town is laid out in an orderly fashion by rational people one time in the past. The city is a series of routes for my children. They do mm-hmm. not have an integrated kind of top-down concept of what that city is in their minds.
Which, is that a good thing or a bad thing?
It's a bad thing.
It's a different thing. Maybe we could think about it. Is it good to not have any notion of spatial distances and relationships?
No.
Well, I don't know. You write your science fiction story and say, what if everybody has GPS in their heads? And then you make a couple of characters and have them interact and you let them do what they would do. I imagine sometimes you're surprised if you're an author.
Oh, yeah.
You do your world building, you put your characters in it, and then you're not sure what they're going to do.
Hmm.
And then find out, given that the world is such and thus and so, you know, like, you couldn't have Pride and Prejudice now.
Hmm, right.
Because Darcy be snooping on Lizzie's Instagram. Or worse. Who knows?
Right.
Why I dig this science fiction stuff. I haven't followed most of the modern stuff. It seems to me there's a whole lot of dystopian stuff that's the popular things now.
Is this dystopian?
A little bit.
Dystopian-ish?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not too... I wouldn't want to live on their Earth. I don't think. And Solaria... It's kind of boring.
You know, his Earth is not dystopian for him, though. It's home, and he really can't conceive of it being any other way. Baley, as written, doesn't seem to feel oppressed by it. Although, at the end of the story, he tells his boss, or his boss's boss, or whoever, some higher up at the organization, about the problems he had seen in Solaria, and he said that Earth shares a number of those problems.
Yeah, he thinks that humans need to get off the planet, that they're too inward.
If humans left the planet 3,000 years later, would they still be humans?
Well, you can read more and find out. I have this note that just made me laugh. So he's got a child. His wife is named Jezebel, believe it or not, but he calls her Jesse. So Elijah and Jezebel are married. That's funny, biblically. And their child is Bentley. And so I saw this note that I made. Bentley Baley?
Right.
Who's going to name your kid Bentley Baley?
Jezebel.
The names are funny.
So you dodged me there. So if humans leave the planet for some thousands of years, not enough for them to morphologically change, right? To get another digit or have an eye migrate on the side of their head like a flounder or any of these sort of weird sort of evolutionary things you would think of. But just so that they are in a different cultural milieu with other sort of cultural pressures on them, how long do they have to be gone before there's not humans, before the good doesn't map onto the good for the home planet?
Well, how about this?
I baked a lot in there, didn't I?
You spend 3,000 years living in an urban environment.
Rut-row.
Are you? What is a human? A human, we haven't evolved.
Right.
We're substantially the same things that we were when we were out hunting mammoth. Who knows what we're going to work on ourselves?
You were supposed to answer that question so I could then make that jump, not giving the...
Oh, wait, let me back up then. Well, how do you want me to answer it?
I don't know.
Okay, yes, if we go out in space for 3,000 years, yes, we might be a little bit different or maybe even a lot different than what we are. Now I'm going to throw the softball to you, and you can say...
Well, McIntyre says that we already have such diverging visions of what the good is that... we have hell getting along already. And if you had humans on Solaria and Aurora and Earth, their differences would be, even though they could all wear the same clothes, would be irreconcilable.
Mm-hmm. You might become alien to each other.
So is it a good idea to do that? Would it be a good idea to put the human race into a position to be alienated and disaffected from its brethren?
They're going to do it anyway.
That's not what we asked. That's the put your 12-year-old on birth control argument.
Yeah. I'm
sorry, Melissa.
We were talking before the show started. I am politically disaffected at the moment. If I'm anything, I'm a distributist.
Yeah.
Distributist. I think a smaller life's better, objectively better. A couple acres, a couple acres in a family. What else do you need?
A loaf of bread, a jug of wine, and thou.
Yeah, but we are, whatever we are, we're perpetually dissatisfied. The Tower of Babel story is a good parable on that. You got to get higher and higher and more. The more might be the less.
Yeah.
You get these galaxy exploration stories. I think there's a big flaw in them anyway, and I'm glad that Asimov picks up on this. So, I see trends in the population, and you read these novels which have humans spreading across the galaxy, and you find out that these planets have billions and billions of people. I'm thinking, no, they don't. No, they don't. We have difficulty replacing our population now. Mm. What would more likely happen is you might have space exploration, but you're going to end up with Solaria. You're not going to end up with, I'm trying to think of a heavy populated fictional world, and I'm blanking out. You're going to end up with Alderaan.
Right. Alderaan.
Or Trantor, which is later in Asimov's books. You're going to end up with places that just have a few people and decide that we're all we need. Mm-hmm. Because children are hard. Are difficult, and if you don't have some ideal of the good, why have them?
Because they're delightful.
Not economically.
Because I'm a man and I came here to play. That's why.
Okay.
It's part of the human experience, and the degree to which you don't do that is the degree which you're missing out on the experience.
Yeah. Well, I've put that into practice. I have a bunch of kids.
I'm at the poker table. And I'm going to play.
Yeah, to be a Solarian without children seems to me extremely sad.
Yeah.
What's the point? I'd go there. I'd be a very bad Solarian. We'd make a lot of babies. I'd have to hide them, though. Dress them up as robots.
Right. Oh, there you go. Yeah. Children are AIs, aren't they?
Until what age?
Oh, forever. Your old lady squeezes one out, and you teach it phonics and the multiplication tables. Man, there's no telling what that little intelligence is going to do. Then it's 17. You're like, hey, me and your mom are going to climb in the back seat and you're driving us to dinner. Well, is it going to musk you and like run into a tree instead of the school bus full of children?
I don't know. They're pretty surprising, though. It's
they're AIs.
Like,
though.
I've told you, I have a child who's bad at math.
I have one of those too.
I don't understand that. Melissa's pretty fair at math. I was pretty good at it. So how's she so bad? Well, because they're their own thing.
Yeah.
they're not an AI that you've programmed.
The positronic brain you put in that one's busted.
No, she's good at other stuff. She's worked hard this year. She passed her college level math course. She didn't get an A, I don't think, but she didn't get an F. So she passed. That was good. She's worked hard.
We'll take it.
But it's just so hard for her and easy for me. And it's hard to, it's like somebody who's tone deaf. I don't understand how you can be tone deaf. I realize intellectually there are such people.
Right.
But to me, tones are like colors that I can see. It's super easy.
Back to these damn computers and them having their own physics and my sister pinching the photo. I was working the other day with a person. They were laying tiles out. I was putting down flooring, and this person was putting down these tiles ahead of me so that I'm crawling around on my knees and knee pads on, you know, putting these tiles in. This person was staging them for me so I wouldn't have to get up, and I just had a tile. I could just keep going. Put the tile down where I would be working. And I said, you need to just take a step back and put that next tile down, you know, like a foot, 2 feet back. Didn't know where back was. Somebody's probably listening to this and doesn't believe me. I see these problems all the time where people really aren't as oriented to the, you know, we know this for like most of the ladies in my life, if you tell them, well, you know, come to the intersection and turn north. What? Like the car, you know, knowing the cardinal directions like that is that evades a lot of people. Well, for people that are in the computer world and have been natively back, forward, up, down in the real world is not as, does not, you know, orient them themselves that way. It does not come as naturally to them.
You see, what you should have said is move that back in Minecraft.
Where's back in Minecraft though?
You just flip around and go the other way.
I guess. Taking the welding class. And welding instructor says, hey, come into the other room. And we've got a new device in there. And we're going to get everybody working with this new device. We go in there. It's Lincoln Welding. There's kind of three big welding companies, Lincoln, Miller, and Hobart. And they've got Lincoln virtual welding machines. I got what they call a coupon. A coupon is just a piece of steel that you would do a test on to test out for a certain kind of welding action, whatever, I don't know. And they got what they call a coupon, and it's a plastic rectangle, maybe 6 inches long, maybe 3-4 inches wide. And I think it has sensors in it, I think. And you put on a virtual reality kind of Oculus Rift looking thing, visor, whatever, and it's got headphones, it's got, you know, goes over your ears as well. And then they put a welding stinger in your hand, and there's a plastic rod there where the welding rod would be. And that plastic rod has teeth on it. It's a rack, and there's a little pinion gear in there. So as you're virtually welding, it retracts that plastic rod. And apparently the end of the rod has some sensors in it as well. So the instructor sets the machine. He says, okay, we're welding with this 6011 rod, and it's this, and it's 1/8 inch, and the steel is this, and mild steel, and blah, blah, blah. And then you weld, and it's virtual. And I've done some welding before, and it seems to be pretty faithful to what welding is like, except you can't stick the rod to the work, the material. You know, if you're not doing it right, you know, and you're trying to strike an arc, you just weld your electrode to the thing, and then you have to unhook your stinger before it turns into a plasma and it melts. I don't know what I think about that. You can practice without any sort of dangers. You're not going to get burned. You're not inhaling weird gases. You know, it's much safer than welding. It's probably cheaper. You know, I'm not burning up welding rod and steel and all that. I don't know what I think about it. You know, will people end up being better real-life welders because of the virtual welding trainer?
Well, but you still have to do actual welding.
You do have to do actual welding. So my question is, other than some danger, but we've already agreed that we're going to be welding. And other than the cost, and I don't think everything's economic, don't we just go weld?
No, because you don't want kids to get burned. Until you're sure they know what they're doing.
Right.
It's like a flight simulator.
Yeah. I thought that the first class would be mostly safety briefing. It was not. And I think one, and that surprised me. And I think one of the reasons was that we would be going straight to a simulator and that perhaps we would, but see, I wonder if the simulator is not going to put us at some sort of danger because it's not hot. It's not throwing sparks.
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to give some of these guys a false sense of security when they're welding that they wouldn't have? If, I mean, you're holding a lightning bolt, man. It's crazy. It's a crazy thing to do. And when you're playing the video game, which is what the VR thing is, it doesn't telegraph how nutty and dangerous and Promethean the whole thing is. I don't know what I think about it. It seems to be very good. Now, that being said, I want to try to get some extra time on it.
But that's preparation for you're going to actually weld.
Right.
What if you had a dating simulator?
Oh, gosh. That's called junior high.
No, I mean like digital.
Oh. Yeah, you can't do it. You can't do it. It doesn't map. It doesn't.
But you might think it maps. And then you might prefer the simulator to the actual flesh and blood girl.
I see what you did.
What did I do?
Are you talking about porn? Internet porn?
Not necessarily. We were talking about Japan earlier. They have all sorts of dating games.
Right.
And androids and stuff. It's coming your way soon, I'm sure. It's entirely possible, and I think it's happened, that people will just say, well, I don't need human interaction.
Mm-hmm. It's very difficult, human interaction.
Mm-hmm. Weird things happen, like children.
Yeah, like Wendell Berry said in that story we covered last week, sometimes more energy can be created than the community can consume, and they end up throwing frozen horse turds at each other.
Yeah.
It's a good story. It is a real live mystery. And it's a real live detective novel.
And we did not spoil it for you.
No, I don't think we did. He does a little Sherlock Holmes nod in there. He says that once all the options have been eliminated, the whatever's left must be the answer. You know, something, whatever that quote is.
Eliminate the impossible, and whatever's left, no matter how improbable, is your answer.
Yeah, and that's that logical, reasonable distinction, right? Like the improbable things just aren't reasonable.
Right.
So Daniel cannot see those things. And yeah, it's a good. It was a delight. I sat down and read the whole darn thing yesterday. It wasn't onerous.
Well, I'm glad you liked it.
Yeah. We're going to read an onerous one for next week.
Yeah, what are we reading?
Holistic Resource Management by one Alan Savory.
How many pages?
Oh, it's... Let's not ask questions like that. It's 506.
Oh, gosh. Can I read every other page?
Sure.
I'm not going to get it till Sunday.
I'll talk about the odds. You talk about the evens.
590 pages. Oh, my goodness. Are there pictures?
There are, in fact.
All right. Yeah, that should be interesting. A lot of people are getting into that earthy stuff. And yeah. I guess this is one of their influential books. I'll be coming at it completely new.
Yeah. There is a growing sort of homesteading, regenerative agriculture movement in the whole world. And if you care about those sorts of things, you've probably heard about Alan Savory and are interested in his ideas. So this is the book that he wrote about that. You can go see a really great... I don't really like TED, as in the TED Talks. I don't really like that shit that much. But there's a great Alan Savory TED Talk out there. You might go look at that in preparation for this. I don't know that anybody would probably read along with us, but I hope they might. If not, go check out the Alan Savory TED Talk, and we'll be talking about this book next week. A lot of folks know about Joel Salatin or Greg Judy. These are kind of regenerative agriculturists, and both of them are big Alan Savory disciples, and I think it'll be very good.
Yep. I'm actually looking forward to it. I'm just complaining about the pages.
Yeah, me too. And one of the reasons, guys, see, we don't pick books on here because we think you're interested. We pick books that we're interested in and that are palatable to us.
Yep. Speaking of podcast, So I talked about this earlier this morning. A lot of you are not commuting anymore. And it might be a reason that a lot of podcast numbers are down throughout the industry, to the degree it's an industry. Well, I just want to remind you that you can listen to us or your other favorite podcast, I don't know who those would be, while you're doing other stuff.
Really?
Yeah. So one of our members said, you know what? When I'm at home, I tend to put on video. Well, don't do that.
That's gross.
Get some headphones, listen to something that's going to stretch your brain a little bit, and do those repetitive, boring tasks that your spouse wants you to do anyway. Wash the car, mow the lawn if your lawn is still growing. I have cheap noise cancelers that I wear that I put them on and I can barely hear my lawnmower. I get a lot done that way. Doing the dishes, you know, walking your perimeter, whatever.
Securing the perimeter, policing your area. Yeah,
you like podcasts because you found us. And you're just not having as much opportunity because you're not stuck in a car. It's a good thing you're not stuck in your car. But we'll find some other times for you to listen.
Yeah, we have a lot of friends in the pod universe. And almost everybody I talk to is flat since about October, which is really interesting to me. Everybody I talk to saw their numbers dip in the April area. You know, a lot of folks weren't going to work in April. But then the numbers kind of rebounded for most of us that I talked to, and they started heading back up. But then, like I said, since October, it's been kind of flat. It's interesting. So I'm speaking to all of you who aren't listening right now. I hope you're not listening because you're reading. How about that? Or doing something else good. Well, there's another Online Great Books podcast. Thank you guys so much for listening. I don't know if this show was any good. Sometimes I do these and feel like I'm either like looking at my own belly button or shouting in the void. And I think I shouted into my belly button this time. I don't know.
No, I think it was good. Okay. It'll be interesting.
We'll hit publish anyway. And then next week, we're going to talk about holistic resource management by Alan Savory. And we are now always offering or fitting to offer one of our gateway sessions. So if you're interested in checking out what seminar is like, you can do that for no cost, no obligation, won't require anything from you, but to go to onlinegreatbooks.com/podcast and just sign up. And then we can let you attend one of our seminars for free and you can see what the heck that's about. We'll send you something short to read, you know, 10, 12, 15, 20 page essay. And then we'll have a seminar with somebody like Master Karl over here. See, if you're not a robot, in the Asimov book, your master, so-and-so. So you can do a seminar with Master Karl over here. It'll be good. Go to onlinegreatbooks.com/podcast and do that. And send a copy of this thing, you know, put it on Edison roll. And then post it to one of your friends and pass the word on. And we'll talk to you next Thursday.